So welcome to the European Studies Center's first Conversations on Teaching Europe. The European Studies Center is part of the University of Pittsburgh's University Center for International Studies. We are a Title VI National Resource Center and a Jean Monnet Center of European Excellence. My name is Kathy Ayres. I am the Outreach Coordinator with the Center, and I am a former high school social studies teacher. Today we have teachers joining us from across Pennsylvania, as well as New York, Illinois, Indiana, and Wisconsin. So thank you so much for your participation. This first conversation today is going to focus on teaching the European migration crisis through primary and secondary sources, as well as personal narratives. During today's conversation, you're going to hear from a professor from the University of Pittsburgh, Dr. Bernie Haggerty, as well as three educators from the Pittsburgh region who are going to share lessons relevant to this topic. So first, I would like to introduce Dr. Bernie Haggerty. He is a senior lecturer with the University of Pittsburgh's Department of History. Dr. Haggerty's fields of interest include modern Britain, modern Europe, and the U.S.-British relations. Some of the courses he teaches include Western Civilization, World War II in Europe, the history of the European Union, and xenophobia in contemporary Europe. Our center is so pleased to have him here today, especially given the fact that I have charged him with talking about the migration crisis in 10 to 15 minutes, which is no small feat. So I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Haggerty to provide us with some background information on this topic.
Okay, I want to thank you, Kathy, for inviting me. And what I have to say here will be basic background. It's going to be short, it's going to be stark to the point of being brutal, but I'll try to end up with a little note of hope. Okay, first, what is the European migration crisis? Pretty simple. Hundreds of thousands of people, by the end of this year, millions of people, are storming the borders of the European Union. They want to get in. They come from Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, Mali, Mauritania, Eritrea, Somalia, Sudan, South Sudan, Albania, Kosovo, Egypt, and Pakistan, and about 20 or 30 more places I haven't even mentioned. 65% of them are young males. That's not what you see on TV. That's not what the television is showing. Television is showing intact families. There are some intact families and children, but most of the people who are coming are young males, about 65%. Very few old people, and some children, as young as 8 or 10 through mid-teens, are coming unaccompanied. But it's mostly young males from 18 to perhaps 30 or 35. As for how they're getting here, multiple routes. You might think of it as like water flowing downhill. You dam up the water in one place, it will find someplace else to overflow and to get in. And that's what's happening. There are, at the moment, four main routes. One is a Western Mediterranean route, coming from Morocco, from Tunisia, across the straits to Spain. This used to be a big route, not so big now. We've kind of shut this one off. A much larger one is a central Mediterranean route. People coming from Egypt and especially from Libya across to Sicily, to the mainland of Italy, and especially to the Italian islands, just little tiny islands of Pantelleria and Lampedusa. Thousands and thousands and tens of thousands are coming by that route. The third route, and the one that just in the last 6 months has become bigger than any of them, is the Eastern Mediterranean route. The way that happens is you work your way up the far side of the Mediterranean any way you can. Some epic journeys from places like Ethiopia or Somalia, you get to Turkey. You travel through Turkey, and there either you get on anything that floats, and a lot of things that don't float very well, and go across the Aegean Sea to the mainland of Greece or to Greek islands, some of which are just off the Turkish coast, or you travel by land from Turkey up through perhaps Romania, Bulgaria, and either way, you go through Greece or through those countries into perhaps Hungary or Slovakia and through Croatia, trying to get into the European Union in that particular way. There's one new strand that's just starting, one new stream that's just starting. That one is purely a land stream, and it's way up north through Ukraine and Russia by land into Hungary and Poland. It's not very big yet, but if they cut off the Eastern Mediterranean route, it probably will get big. Most of those coming in are not coming just by leaving their country and coming in any way they can. They're using or being used by traffickers. There's an immensely sophisticated network of human smugglers, human traffickers. They advertise on the internet. They boast about how honest they are, which they aren't. They help people get in. It will cost anywhere from several hundred to several thousand dollars to get in. This means, first of all, that the people who are coming are not the very poorest people. What you're getting are people who can somehow dredge up the money. Maybe if they own a piece of land, they will sell that land wherever they are. Maybe their family's life savings. Maybe a whole extended family will chip in to send one young man, usually, to Europe. Now, all of these people are undocumented. They're illegal. That doesn't mean they can't be made legal. They can apply for asylum, for refugee status, but they're undocumented, which is a good part of the difficulty. Now, why they're coming? They're coming because it's their only hope of a decent life. The places they're from are in terrible, terrible, terrible shape. Some of them are literally failed states that provide no government, that virtually have no government, such as Libya and Somalia. Others, they have a government, but it doesn't do very well at providing jobs, at providing basic personal security, at providing hope for the future. The only hope for the future for these people is to make it into the European Union, preferably Germany or Sweden, but making it into the European Union. It's a sacrifice to come in more ways than just leaving where you're from, leaving your home. It's a sacrifice because there's a very good chance that you're going to be victimized on the way. Any money you have, the traffickers or bandits will take it away from you. And there's a very good chance that you will die. So far on the Mediterranean alone, about 3,000 people have died, have drowned this year. There will be more. And that doesn't count those who died getting to the shores of the Mediterranean or getting to Turkey. We have no idea how many of those there are. A lot. Okay. Some of them are refugees of war coming from Syria, from Libya, Sudan and South Sudan, Afghanistan, Iraq. These people have a legal right to refugee status if they can get to Europe and ask for such status and prove that they are refugees. Others are economic refugees, people coming from Albania and Kosovo. They have no legal right to come, and they will probably be deported. They're coming for a better life, not because they can't stay where they are. There's also one last thing that's happening, particularly with Syrian refugees. That is, we're seeing the beginning of something that could be huge in future years. Those coming from Syria are coming not only because of the war in Syria, but because Syria is in the midst of a years-long drought. In other words, they are the beginning of what is likely to be climate refugees. If the predictions about global warming are true, there could be God knows how many in the future. Numbers that could dwarf what we've got now. Okay. The effects of their coming. I think I'm being pretty sure here.
You're doing very well.
Okay, being pretty sure. The effects of their coming. Actually, two things to be said. One is that the effects of their coming are incalculable. Nobody knows everything that it means. I'll talk about a few possibilities. The second is there's an irony that they're coming now, that they see the European Union as the promised land now, because the European Union itself is in trouble right now. It's in trouble politically. We're not even sure it's going to last. It's in trouble economically. Their economy since the Great Recession of 2008 has been stagnant at best, and in many places kind of receding a bit. Some places are doing pretty well. Many places are not. So there's an irony that they're coming at such a time. Now the effects. First of all, the immediate effects. It's kind of unfair where they're coming to, because by definition, they're going to come to the fringes of the European Union, to the countries on the fringes. And most notable here is Greece. Greece is, at this moment, an economic basket case. They almost collapsed over the summer. They came literally within hours of what would have been a national economic collapse this summer. But the largest number of refugees are coming right now to Greece. Greece is stony broke. They can barely feed themselves. And it's a small country, about 11 million people. Every day, just on the Greek islands, right off the Turkish coast, every day right now, 7,000 migrants land, every single day. More land on the islands that are farther in, some land on the Greek mainland. Greece has no resources to take care of them. None. Zero. They can't afford to buy food. They have no way to house them. They have no way to care for these refugees. Italy is getting a lot of refugees, and they're not in great shape either. When the Eastern Mediterranean stream proceeds from Greece, or bypasses Greece, and goes up toward Croatia, Slovakia, Hungary, those are some of the poorest countries in the European Union. And they too are having these refugees descend upon them with no way to care for them, with no way to provide them what they need. So one of the things they're doing is just shuttling them straight through. Okay, you get to our borders, we'll put you on buses, we'll take you to the next border. Turkey has been doing that for a long time now, and people don't appreciate what Turkey is doing. So it's making immediate difficulties for them. It's even making difficulties in their preferred destinations, which is first of all Germany, then Sweden, then Britain would be nice, France would be nice, because even those places are finding difficulties in finding places to house them. In Germany, they're expecting 1.5 million migrants in that one country by the end of the year. They've got to find places to put 1.5 million migrants. And in the long term, these people might be of economic use to them. In the short term, they're not. In the short term, they're a burden. Moreover, one of the things that the European Union prides itself on is its open borders. Something called the Schengen area, in which it's literally open borders. Once you get into any one of those countries, you can travel to all of them. And most countries on the continent of Europe within the European Union belong to it. Now, that principle of free movement is being challenged because a lot of countries are saying, we don't want them. And we certainly don't want them without any documentation. We don't want them just flooding in here. So countries are closing their borders. Austria has more than once already closed its borders, which is not supposed to happen. There are other things that are happening behind all this. One is, as refugees are being accepted, and the second I'll talk about how well they're being accepted, locals are coming to resent those refugees. And far right-wing anti-immigrant parties are getting stronger and stronger. In some cases, they're the second or third largest parties in these countries, and they're going to get stronger than that. It is possible that they will form governments or form part of coalition governments. And at that time, they will do their best to kick out all these refugees. There have been, in Germany alone, and Germany has been very welcoming of immigrants, this year, 500 attacks, 500 arson attacks, beatings, attacks on places where refugees are housed. That's in one country, Germany, 500 separate attacks. This is going to change the politics of Europe. It's going to change it in ways that we're just not sure about, except we know that the right-wing anti-immigrant parties are going to be stronger. It will affect Europe's identity. They won't be exactly what they were before. They will lose parts of their identity. They'll become something new. It affects even things like a strengthening of anti-Semitism in many cases. But I will quit here with just a couple of notes of hope. I hope that was stark enough. But there are a couple of notes of hope. Just two. I hope there's more than that, but two that I can think of offhand. One is the outpouring of compassion toward these refugees has been surprising and heartening. Many, many people, including some that you wouldn't expect to do this, have helped out these refugees, have welcomed these refugees. The Pope, of course, the Pope is housing one refugee family in the Vatican, and suggested that all the Catholic parishes around Europe do the same. They're not, but he suggested. But many, many others, and not just maybe people you would expect. Angela Merkel, the most powerful politician in Europe, Germany's leader, who is from a center-right coalition, has put all of her political capital on the line to help these refugees. She doesn't accept everybody. If you don't qualify as a refugee, she and everybody else, every other country, will kick you back out. But she's doing everything she can to make Germany welcoming to refugees. The EU in general is pushing hard to find some solution for this. Some of the solutions are kind of punitive. They're putting patrols on the Mediterranean to stop boats before they can reach Europe. But others are at least moving in the right direction. So recently it was agreed a 120,000 refugees would be accepted and parceled out to all the countries of the European Union. That isn't nearly enough. That isn't even a tenth enough, but it's a start. Now, this too has its problems. It won't work because if you say, okay, we're accepting you and you're going to have to go to Slovakia, they ain't going to stay in Slovakia. They don't want to be there. They will go to Germany. It's a much better place to be. But still, the outpouring of compassion has been hopeful. And there is also a long-term note of hope, because for all the short-term financial burden, every study and practical experience shows that over the long term, migrants tend to be good for your economy. Migrants tend to have lower rates of welfare dependency than native-born people. Migrants tend to work hard. Migrants tend to be economically dynamic as a whole and to be culturally dynamic. Europe will lose something in its identity, but it will gain something. It will gain something new. And hopefully worthwhile. I don't know how many minutes that was, but that's the quick summary of what's going on.
Thank you. Well, I'd like to take a couple of minutes before we move to our teacher presenters, just to open it up for questions for Dr. Haggerty. So if you are joining us remotely, there is a chat feature, and you can share any questions that you might have with Dr. Haggerty via the chat feature, or if we have anyone that is actually in the room that has any questions for clarification or follow-up questions, we can kind of ask those at this moment before moving on.
Dr. Haggerty, I'd ask you, what has Russia's response been to this immigration crisis?
Russia's general response, They don't have any responses, immediate, direct thing that's affecting the EU, because they're not much of a part of it. A little bit, but not very much. They have had people from the so-called southern tier, from below Russia, coming into Russia. Their response has been very, very bad. People are incarcerated in something that looks like Soviet-era concentration camps. The government makes no attempt to protect them or help them. Russia has deliberately tried to be as unwelcoming to them as it possibly can. Whether that will have to change, I don't know. I'll believe it when I see it. Russia has not been helpful. It has been only peripherally involved in the immediate crisis that's facing the EU. They are very good at criticizing the EU about this. They're happy to do that. So, but that's been their response. So.
We do have a question from one of our participants.
We do. She asks, what do you perceive to be the consequences for schooling of refugee kids in EU countries?
Yeah. This has not been properly worked out. They don't know what to do. They really don't. The good part is that refugees generally want to go to school and that their kids will probably learn German or Swedish or whatever it is very quickly. There are some programs, especially in Sweden, to teach anyone who comes in the local language. Denmark does the same. Other places do the same. But there is no worked out immediate way to educate these people, especially since they don't know who's going to be allowed to stay and who's going to have to leave. It's one of the many things that the EU has not figured out and that individual countries have not figured out. They don't know where they're going to find people with the appropriate languages or how they're going to assimilate this large number of people who don't, children who don't have the appropriate languages. This is for the future. This they're working out on the fly. So.
We do have another question. The question is, what is your take on the significance of using the terms migrant versus refugee or other terms?
Yeah, there's a big fuss about this. I really don't want any part of the fuss. The basic division is a refugee is someone who's coming from, say, Syria, or someone who would be persecuted at home. And under EU law, such people can file for refugee status and they will be allowed to stay. Not only will they be allowed to stay, but under law, they will be allowed to bring in their families. Now, it gets very complicated because there's a thing called the Dublin Protocol, which says that the first country you go to in Europe or the first safe country you show up in, you're supposed to stay there, and nobody is doing that. That would mean they'd have to stay in Greece, and that would be hopeless. They want to go to Germany or Sweden or the United Kingdom, whatever. But I don't know, remind me the question again.
Oh, yes, yeah. Using the terms
okay.
Migrant versus refugee.
Yeah, refugees are those who, under European law, would have a right to stay. They can apply for asylum. Migrants can be used either as a general term for everybody or can just mean those who are economic migrants or who otherwise don't have a right to stay. As I said, it gets complicated because of the legal terms. The more loaded terms are illegals, which technically they all are at the moment, but it can also specifically mean those who are coming only for a better life, rather than because they can't stay where they are. The far right parties will use the term illegals. They would rather that be the discourse rather than migrants or refugees. So those would be the difference. Probably the neutral term is migrants, the favorable term is refugees. We don't like these people as illegals. So, undocumented can also be used.
Any other questions?
Yeah, Lauren? The decisions that need to be made about mm-hmm. how we're going to school these people, where they mm-hmm. can stay, what ability do the individual countries have to make these decisions versus the EU?
Yeah. This is one of the sad things. It's mostly on the individual countries. The EU as a whole has not been very helpful to this point. They're struggling, they're trying. But the EU has been very little help, for instance, in providing patrols to stop people or to rescue people. So mostly it's the individual countries, once they arrive in these countries, that have to take care of them. These countries have their own traditions regarding this. Germany, they've been pretty good at it. Sweden, I've been mentioning Sweden a lot because they're the country which is most open to refugees in all of Europe, or migrants, or whatever you want to call them, in all of Europe. They made a conscious decision. We'll allow everyone in and try to integrate them into Swedish society. But it's up to them. In Germany sometimes, it's not even the country. It's the lands, the equivalent of our states, that have to come up with the resources and make many of the decisions. So it's primarily the individual countries that have to make most of the decisions. They do have to abide by EU law regarding refugees. But mostly the EU isn't a whole lot of help. They're struggling on how to become more helpful. So far, not a whole lot of help. So.
I have a quick question. Do you anticipate, there's a new route where a lot of the Syrians have gone to Russia and are now going through Russia north to Norway into the Arctic Circle.
There is that one. That's a very small one so far.
Do you anticipate that will increase, or it's just it's just a very small fragment?
Yeah, I don't know. Now it is a very small fragment. I don't know, but again, the analogy of water flowing down. You dam it up here, it'll go someplace else. So it could become major. It'd be a little harder. Going through Russia is not good. And it's a long way to the Arctic Circle. It gets cold there in the winter. So I'd be surprised if it became a really major route. But maybe.
I think we have one last question, and I think we're going to then move on to our next presenter.
Great. The question is, what should the role of the USA be in the solution of the crisis to which it has contributed in some way? Is this a European problem or a global one?
Yeah. Wow. That is the hardest question. The Obama administration is trying to do something. They've proposed accepting a larger number of refugees. I believe we have a quota of 85,000 per month at the moment. And the Obama administration wants to bump that up to 100,000. As for the question of what role we have in it, I'm not going to touch that one right now. I'm sorry, but I won't. We may or may not be able to do that because we're so strict on letting people in. We insist on strict background checks so they're not terrorists and so on. And that's very expensive. We can only do this. We can only allow more in if Congress allocates money for this, which is a good chance it won't. U.S.'s role, I would hope we would allow people in because we're the best in the world at integrating people in. I mean, that's what the U.S. is. We're founded by everybody and their big sister. So I would hope we allow more people in because we're better at it than Europe is. I would hope we would provide aid in any way we can. For instance, maybe the U.S. could help with naval patrols on the Mediterranean. We have a bigger navy than anybody else does. I would hope we would find some money someplace to help out the countries of Europe. I would hope that we would support the countries of Europe and pressure them, as we have done in other cases, such as the Greek debt crisis, to find a solution. Those are some of the things that we can do. Again, for how responsible we are for this, I don't think we're primarily responsible. We really don't. How responsible we are, I really don't want to touch. I guess the last thing I'd say is, whoever's responsible, we can't solve this. It is primarily a European Union problem. It is a testing time for the European Union. If they screw it up too bad, the European Union, as we know it, may not exist a couple of years from now. If they do a really good job, they could be stronger than they are now. I am less optimistic than I wish I was. But it's not It's not something we can solve.